Thank you. Thank you. Numbers, you're the third service on this beautiful day. And while our numbers are a little small, our hope is mighty this night. And what a treasure it is to share it with you, especially in light of our beautiful music that we will soon enjoy. Won't you stand? Arise, O Jerusalem, stand upon the height and look toward the east and see your children gathered from west and east at the word of the Holy One. Amen. Amen. O great mystery and wonderful sacrament, that animals should see the newborn Lord lying in a manger. Blessed is Mary, the mother of God, whose womb was worthy to bear Christ the Lord. Hallelujah. Almighty God, who in the incarnation of your Son has revealed to us the holiness of creation, be pleased to bless and hallow this image of his sacred birth, so that those who gaze upon it may behold this mystery, whereby humanity shares in your very nature. Through Christ our Lord. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Excelsis Deo. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, you have caused this holy night to shine with the brightness of the true light. Grant that we who have known the mystery of that light on earth may also enjoy him perfectly in heaven, where with you and the Holy Spirit he lives and reigns one God, and glory everlasting. Amen.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult with dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The word of the Lord.
And his wonders come on me. A reading from Titus. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity, and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous for good deeds. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the words should be registered. This was the first registration, and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel and a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in a manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about the child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. And this is the gospel of the Lord. Drop down, ye heavens from above, and let the skies pour down the righteous one. Amen. There is a pocket of rural northeast Oklahoma that I love, where my parents used to live, just off a sprawling lake in what we call green country, even though this time of year it's an all certain golden color, spread out on flat terrain. The horizon as far as the eye can take you. It's beautiful country, and it's delightfully simple. Never much news, never much scandal. Most folks all know one another, and even when they don't, they still kind of act like they do. When I think of that great Christmas hymn, Silent Night, I more often think not of that country. I more often than not think of that country and not Bethlehem. When we sing those lyrics, all is calm, and all is bright. I've spent many Christmases there, and it is always so still and calm and bright. So you can imagine the hullabaloo that transformed some 11 years ago when a baby albino deer began to take refuge with a herd of black cows. First, albino deer are very rare, about 1 in 30,000. Their fur is snow white, without blemish, and the inside of their ears are a pinkish red. They stand out amidst all the green and golden, blending in with nothing, and dangerously easy to spot. It is for this reason that they are almost always shunned by the herd, rejected at birth by their mothers and the other members of the family, and left to fend for themselves. It's cruel, but it's also nature. A herd with an albino deer becomes a herd well noticed. They are a danger to the herd, and so they are expelled. This deer had experienced such a similar fate It wandered away from its family into unknown farmland and woods, unsure of what it would do without the community it so desperately would need to survive. It would walk through daunting underbrush until it found a clearing on the eastern shore of the Neosho River, a modest farm on the edge of State Route 4510, peppered with about 80 cows who called the clearing home. The deer had found its new family. It stayed with the herds, mimicking its behavior and playing with its young calves. It snacked out of their feed trough and drank from their watering holes. It even began to chew its cud, even though that's not really a thing that deer do. That's how committed this deer was to fitting in. And the astonishing thing is, the deer did fit in. The herd of cattle found nothing strange about the whole affair. Or at least if they did, they didn't say anything about it. These are classy Oklahoma cows. So they welcomed the deer in as one of them. Because she was first discovered on Christmas Eve, the deer became known by the locals as Christmas. She lived with the herd for the rest of her life. And she became a beacon of hope to the folks who came to know and to love the legend of Christmas the deer. The owner didn't want any media attention for fear it would dismantle the odd symbiosis, but many of the folks in the area knew. Some of those folks were fighting battles you find in any community, communities just like our own, job and financial insecurities, health issues, grief and loss, depression and addiction. For many of them, the idea of a little white deer finding safety with a herd of cattle seemed just obscure enough, just outlandish enough, that if God could pull that off, perhaps God could be there for them, that their challenges and burdens would not be insurmountable after all. There was something just about the whole thing. The rest of the deer lived in hiding in the woods, always mindful of the predators that lurk in the underbrush. But Christmas rested proudly alongside her cow colleagues, just as peaceful as they were, her fur still unscarred. An animal once destined for a quick death, now sunbathed proudly in the open, buffeted by these cows doing the same, an echo of the lion lying with the lamb, all playing out on a modest Oklahoma farm. Now, this is where I pause off my text for a second. My folks are here today, and my dad reminded me that at some point during they moved the herd, then they sell the herd, and they moved it like 2 miles, and they loaded it all up into a car, and they didn't put it in a car. Could you imagine that? But they moved the cows, and they tried to load Christmas in, but she wouldn't do it. So they just moved the cows some 2 miles, and the next morning she was there. When she eventually died, she had lived 3 times longer than the average wild Oklahoma deer. Every Christmas Eve, as we would make our way home from church, we would pull off the road and pull into the farm to see if we could find her, just to catch a glimpse of her snow-white fur and be reminded that the world would, in fact, be all right after all. Now, there are two options for the Christmas gospel lesson. Luke's retelling is familiar, and it's what you just heard. I once replaced it with the other option, John's prologue, and I was almost chased out of my former parish for doing that. It's like I had taken away their shepherds and angels, and I won't ever do that again. But I still like the John version more. John does not begin with the description of Bethlehem or the predicament of Mary and Joseph. John begins where Genesis begins, from the beginning of time. John begins with a lightless void, mute and still. And from there, from the very beginning, John describes the companionship of the Word with God. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. The two were one, John says, and the Word that was with God and was God became life. It came and it lived among us as one of us, sharing in our joys and fears. And that life was the light of the world. That becoming life is what we're here to celebrate tonight. And we celebrate it because we still live in the light of that life, the light that could not be overcome by darkness. That light brightens our lives today, as it has since that night in Bethlehem all those many years ago, shining upward toward the heavens, pointing to the God who sent the Word into the world. The Word that is life, that is light, points our hearts through the darkness, taking our hand and saying, "Follow me this way. This is the way to salvation. Come with me. Everything will be okay." The Word that is life, that is light, is love. We know it as love. And not as a love of a place or a thing, a favorite restaurant or shoes, not as infatuation between two people, or even the love a parent can have for a child. The Word that is life, that is light, is a love far deeper than that, impossibly bright and unshakable, and one that emanates from God alone. My friends, if you are here in church every week, or if you haven't been in years, I want you to know this. God loves you. God loves you. God created you out of love and for the sake of loving you. God loves you so much that God broke into the world to be with us, taking on our form as his own, sharing in our highs and lows, our fears and joys, looking us straight in the eye and saying, "I know what this earthly life is like because I have traveled it with you. I know what it is to hope and to laugh, to cry and to cry out. You have never been alone, and you are not alone, and you will never be alone because I was with you. I was with you from the beginning of time when the earth was a formless void. I was there, and I will be with you until the end of the age." The Nativity story is so much more than one wild night in Bethlehem. It captures the whole sweep of creation and redemption. God created the heavens and the earth. God created humankind, and in the fullness of time, God came into the humanness of one of us, paving the way for our redemption. When his hour had come, he died for us. And then, even then, that love did not end. Through his death, he conquered death and paved for us the way to eternal life, the way that is illuminated in our hearts by the life that is the light of the world, light that pierces the darkness like a bleached white deer among the cattle. When our life's burdens overwhelm us, when the illness feels relentless or the despair unwavering, when the fury burns unending in our hearts, and the anxiety shakes us to our core, when grief finds us, when depression finds us, when hopelessness finds us, when shame finds us, what we know is that because of this night, we will be okay. Jesus came into the world, and more than anything else in the Gospels, he tells us, "Be not afraid, do not worry, trust me, we got this, you and me." He calls us to live as blithely as Christmas the deer, free, innocent, and unweary, aware of life's afflictions, but unfazed by them, and willing, perhaps, to walk miles to find the herd. And if that seems absurd, that there is no darkness that the light cannot shake, remember that Jesus came into the world in the most absurd of ways, entering the human experience not in the palace he deserved, but in a cave in Bethlehem, a modest dwelling filled with livestock and love, the smell of hay commingling with the odor of afterbirth and animal waste. That's how the story starts. In the beginning was that. And God made that holy. God made it good. He made it worth Sunday school children reciting in pageantries thousands of years later. If that love seems absurd, that there is no darkness that the light cannot shake, remember that even if the worst happens to us, we breathe our last, Jesus still lives. The light is still burning. A new life awaits us in the heavens. Even in death, we'll be all right. If that love seems absurd, that there is no darkness that the light cannot shake, then remember, there is still a plain in Oklahoma where an albino deer lived well past her years, her white fur without blemish, snuggled up with a herd of cattle, all resting still and unafraid. That's our gift this night, to know that God's love for us is so absurd, so unqualified, and so undeserved, so perfect and so relentless that no matter what comes our way, all will be right with the world. All will be calm. All will be bright. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. Gracious and loving God, in Jesus you have filled all humanity with your divine life. Hear our prayers of joy and thanksgiving as we offer our supplications to you, saying, Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace to God's people on earth.
You have entrusted the church with good news of great joy for all people. Inspire our witness that we may spread the light of Jesus' love to all humanity. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace to God's people on earth. Let your power and compassion guide those who exercise authority on earth, that they may be servants of peace, bringing comfort and security to all who are vulnerable. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace to God's people on earth. Embrace with your eternal protection all who are poor, refugees and the displaced, those threatened by violence, and families with no place to call their home. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace to God's people on earth. Fill the community with hospitality and generosity, that we may care for one another and celebrate the joy of your presence in our humanity. Glory to God in the highest heaven, and peace to God's people on earth. We entrust to your divine grace all for whom we pray, remembering especially those whose burdens we carry in our hearts, the sick and lonely, the anxious and the grieving, and for those who live amidst war. We give thanks for shepherds and all the vigilant who work while others sleep. Hear our grateful thanksgiving for all the gifts and blessings in our lives, especially this church, as it answers your call for a new season. We entrust into your eternal arms those who have died, especially those we remember always at Christmas time.
Loving God, the joyful message of the angels fills us with gladness as we celebrate the coming of the Christ child to live among us in vulnerable humility. Let your divine light so dwell within us that we may treasure your words, ponder them in our hearts, and continue the work of Christ's incarnation in our day. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
And the peace of the Lord be always with you. Well, good evening. Merry Christmas to you. For those who were here this morning when we celebrated the fourth Sunday of Advent, I heard a few Merry Christmases and I snuffed them out. And I said, you have to wait till either the 4 or the 10. We have had a day full of beautiful worship, and this is just the capstone on all of it. I'm reminded that the cave in which Jesus was born was a small place. And this feels a little bit like that, not a crowd, but rather something small and intimate and tremendously holy. And so how lucky we are, how fortunate we are and blessed to be here this night and to share with one another the hope we find in this feast day and in the incarnation of our Lord. We have a lot of people to thank for making this so beautiful, especially those who greened our church, those who donated for the greening and the flowers, our choir that's worked on this for several weeks and months, I think, and Stephen, who's we're three in. We got one to go, one more tomorrow. If this is of any interest to you, know that our community is new in this home and eager to grow, and so you are finding us at a wonderful time as we begin a new season. And we'd love for you to join us in that season. So the best way to do that is to keep in touch with you and tell you about all that we have planned. But know that we would be so delighted to have you join our fellowship and grow as we grow into our new journey with one another. That journey continues on January 6th when we celebrate the Feast of the Epiphany. That is our feast day as the Church of the Epiphany. And so we will gather here 12 days after Christmas on Saturday evening at 5 p.m. to celebrate the Feast of the Epiphany. Won't you join us for this wonderful day? It'll be special. And then we return again Sunday morning for a different feast day. They put these back to back in the calendar. The baptism of our Lord, that we celebrate on January 7th. And it's also the last day that we will be spending with Stephen Rapp, our interim music director. And I know that we are thrilled to celebrate your ministry with us and wish you all the best as you enter into retirement. We will certainly miss you, and we'll have plenty of time between now and then to say just that. Now walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
There's a star in the east on Christmas morn.
Rise up, shepherd, follow.
It will lead to the place where the Savior's born.
Rise up, shepherd, follow.
Leave your sheep and leave your lamb.
Rise up, shepherd, follow.
Leave your ewes and leave your lambs.
Rise up, shepherd, follow.
Follow, follow. Rise up, shepherd, follow.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We
let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
Which is right, we give him thanks and praise.
It is truly right to glorify you, Father, and to give you thanks. For you alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light inaccessible from before time and forever. Fountain of life and source of all goodness, you made all things and filled them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day, and beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim you and glorify your name as we sing. We acclaim you, Holy Lord, glorious in power. Your mighty works reveal your wisdom and love. You formed us in your own image, giving the whole world into our care, so that in obedience to you, our Creator, we might rule and serve all your creatures. When our disobedience took us far from you, you did not abandon us to the power of death. In your mercy, you came to our help, so that in seeking you, we might find you. Again and again, you called us into covenant with you, and through the prophets, you taught us to hope for salvation. Father, you loved the world so much that in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son to be our Savior, incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners, freedom, to the sorrowful, joy. To fulfill your purpose, he gave himself up to death, and rising from the grave, destroyed death and made the whole creation new. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose for us, he sent the Holy Spirit, his own first gift for those who believe, to complete his work in the world and to bring to fulfillment the sanctification of all. When the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, his heavenly Father, having loved his own who were in the world, He loved them to the end. At supper with them, he took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Father, we now celebrate this memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and his descent among the dead, proclaiming his resurrection and ascension to your right hand, awaiting his coming in glory, and offering to you from the gifts you have given us, this bread and this cup. We praise you and we bless you. We praise you, we bless you, we give thanks to you, and we pray to you, Lord our God. Lord, we pray that your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Remember, Lord, your one holy Catholic and apostolic church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, and preserve it in peace. And grant that we may find our inheritance with Mary Theotokos, with patriarchs and matriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, with shepherds and magi, and all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God, given for you, the people of God.
Oh.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. Thank you. May Almighty God, who sent his Son to take our nature upon him, bless you in this holy season. Scatter the darkness of shame and fear, and brighten your heart with the light of his holiness. May God, who sent his angels to proclaim the glad news of the Savior's birth, fill you with joy and make you heralds of the gospel. May God, who in the Word made flesh, joined heaven to earth and earth to heaven, give you his peace and favor. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this night and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.